growing an audience, starting a nonprofit business, and how to launch a podcast with Dr. Shawn Seguin. Stay inspired.
So Shawn, I was thinking we could dive in learning more about the Wild Prairie Winds.
Sure, yeah, I'd love to. So the Wild Prairie Winds began at the University of Iowa in 2017. The group was formed as sort of the teaching assistants there at the University of Iowa. So all five of the members served, you know, like I said, some sort of teaching capacity, you know, all DMA students. And, you know, over the years, you know, some members came in, some members came out. Right now, there's only two original remaining members, our flute player, Daniela, and our horn player, Katie. So I joined the group in 2018, along with our oboe player, Jenna. In 2019, that's when our clarinetist, Kim, joined. And, you know, it was always, you know, sort of in the talks that we would become, you know, more of a professional organization. I think anyone who's tried forming a chamber group knows how much of a challenge it can be to find, you know, five members who are like-minded enough, but still are able to bring in some of their own unique chemistry and ideas into the group. And, you know, we're just so fortunate that, you know, all five of us, you know, do that. We're, you know, we're very passionate about, you know, being this nonprofit and being an organization. But at the same time, we're able to bring in, you know, unique ideas. It was right around, 2018, 2019 that we kind of took the group pretty seriously. And by seriously, we knew that all five of us were going to kind of graduate around the same time, give or take a year. And, you know, that kind of presented a very unique opportunity. And we asked ourselves if we wanted to stay together, if so, at what capacity we wanted to kind of stay together whether if we wanted to be, you know, just sort of a quintet and, you know, that's it, sort of play local gigs or whatever, or if we wanted to establish ourselves, you know, as an organization, an LLC, a nonprofit. And, you know, so it was right around that time that we really decided, okay, we want to be, you know, not only stay together, but we do want to be some sort of an organization. So we gravitated towards the nonprofit. And so, you know, we kind of began introducing some of those elements, you know, sort of to outline, we began doing more meetings, or actually just started to have meetings. Once every other week, we would get together before school started and just kind of outline. Wasn't necessarily any music, but it was just more of the business side. You know, okay, so we have these opportunities coming up. And it was kind of a, you know, the nice thing with the Wild Prairie Winds is that we weren't necessarily a quintet. And we kind of branded ourselves like that so that there wasn't this expectation that at gigs that there was, you know, a full five members. And it also kind of gave us the flexibility to where I know that, like, Kim and I, when we shared an office, the two of us would go out quite frequently. You know, Daniela, myself, and Jenna would go out, Katie and myself, you know, to various, you know, retirement homes or to schools to do educational programs. And it all just kind of depended on, you know, all of our schedules, and that kind of allowed us a lot of flexibility. So, you know, but that also required a lot of planning, you know, and okay, so these three people are going to be at, you know, this retirement home, but we have a gig for another one. Of course, if all five of us could go, that was the most opportune. So, you know, so we started to introduce that started introducing meetings. We also introduced a lot of roles within the group, so that extended beyond our own instruments. So to give kind of like an idea, I actually, although right now I'm, you know, director of education and programming, I actually began as public relations and marketing. So I handled the social media, I handled answering, you know, emails and all that, and, you know, it worked out kind of well. You know, I personally like doing social media stuff, but the type of social media that I like to do, like if you look at my Instagram, I tend to post like stock photos of reeds and stock photos of my bassoon and all that. Very rarely do I go out of my way and do some sort of like promotion of an event. So what I decided to do, you know, Daniela had expressed interest in being in my role, and it was very easy for us to kind of rearrange the group at that point. You know, so that really gave us a full year to kind of navigate. And what that also gave us is this very nice safety net. Because once you establish yourself as a nonprofit, once you fill out the paperwork and you say, okay, well, this person is director or executive director, this person is director of finance, this person is president, vice president, you have your board, then it becomes a much more difficult process than just simply saying, hey, I'm going to switch my role, you know, and doing it that way. And also, too, you know, it kind of allowed us to do our own research. You know, all five of us, luckily, you know, we're in our graduate programs, you know, and with that, too, you know, it was kind of a double-edged sword. We spent so much time, you know, honing our craft as musicians. But all five of us, although, you know, Katie and myself had taken time off school to teach and to be our own, you know, musicians, to develop ourselves. There's only so much that you can kind of bring to that. And so there was a lot of, you know, research that we did, that we had to do to discover, well, what does it really mean to become a nonprofit? And I find, you know, especially a lot of groups that are trying to break into that nonprofit, it's a very daunting process, because a lot of times we hear, oh, it's paperwork. Oh, it's very hard. Oh, you're going to have to wait a very long time. Which I hate to say, all of that is true. But at the same time, too, it's really not as bad, I think, as what some people make it out to be. I think that there's some caveats that you can do, some ways that can make the process a bit easier. And of course, I speak from, you know, being in a chamber organization that has, you know, very small amount of members in it. You know, if this was a larger organization, of course, more people presents more complications. And same with, I think, less people. I think the less amount of people that you have presents a few complications as well, especially getting started out and finding these board members. But in either case, you know, the sort of the early stages of the Wild Prairie Winds, leading up to the nonprofit, and, you know, sort of our idea as far as like getting into it and wanting to establish ourselves as an organization. It's been about 4 years, since our, ensemble's conception. Like I said, about 2017, maybe 2016, if I'm remembering correctly, and then really kind of establishing ourselves as that organization, taking that commitment, 2018, 2019. And not to say that we hadn't discussed that before, but that was really when we were like, okay, let's do this. We all know what we want to do. We were very honest with ourselves. In discussions, you know, And, you know, from that point forward, you know, we kind of did, I guess you could say, like a trial run for about a year, maybe a little bit longer. And then, you know, once COVID hit, in March 2020, you know, the five of us had a very serious, you know, sit down, you know, and discuss, like, is this something we want to do? And, you know, this is something that is very important in, you know, constructing this nonprofit, is really, like, you have to be honest, not only with your members, but with yourself. Because this is a huge commitment. You know, so we kind of went into this meeting, you know, from that point on, like, what is our goals for, where do we see individually the goals for the group in a year, 3 years, 5 years, you know, and sort of seeing where we all are. And, you know, the big thing with all five of us is we went in and whatever happened, whatever choice we made, when we left the group, we knew that we were all still going to be friends, you know, we were all going to be colleagues, you know. You know, we're very fortunate that all five of us still wanted to be a part of the group and wanted to go on ahead with the nonprofit. So that was in March, and we began the paperwork in March. And then it probably was, I'm trying to remember, it was sometime over the summer that we got nationally recognized as a nonprofit. So, and keep in mind too that, you know, this was a time that, you know, when COVID hit, there were no gigs, there was nothing. So, and we as an organization had quite a bit planned out. So this, now that all those plans had gone by the wayside, you know, this was our focus. And we kind of like fully committed to it. And with that too, we had done, you know, due diligence. We had done our research. We had taken the time to, you know, really make sure that this was the right decision as a, not only as an organization, but also for us individually. So the whole process, looking at it from large scale, from the group's conception to present day is right around, like you said, that 4 or 5 year mark. And the nonprofit portion, from the research all the way to the acknowledgement, the getting nationally recognized, was about a good year, maybe year and a half. So, and of course, if you have background in that as well, if you have more of a business background or have done the due diligence, that's going to expedite things significantly. And we were lucky too, you know, we had kind of taken our time as well, doing the research. It just so happened that at that time, at the University of Iowa, through the Chamber Music Residency Program, there's a group called the Spectral Quartet, which was a string quartet that was doing their chamber residency. It was a year-long residency. And two of our members, Kim and Jenna, were part of that. And so we were not only able to establish a connection with them, but we were able to reach out to them because they had been through the process. So it was, you know, whenever they were here, you know, we would meet with them and it would be a, hey, you know, what do you think of these ideas? Or what did you do at this stage? You know, because that's also the nice thing too, is that there are so many of these organizations that have done this. You know, just off the top of my head, there's Spectral, there's WinSync, fantastic quintet down in Houston, Texas. And there's a number of other organizations down. I think Loop 38 is another one, Monarch Chamber Players. Another one, of course, coming from Michigan, I have to, you know, give a special shout out to Acropolis Reed Quintet, really fantastic Reed Quintet. And, you know, we've reached out to them and they provided some feedback as well. They have a summer seminar I think the registration is still going on, and it's a really fantastic opportunity if you're interested in developing your organization into a nonprofit and kind of taking those steps. But that's sort of the nice thing too, is that, you know, we were able to do that due diligence, and luckily with Spectral being on site, it gave us that, you know, more connection where it was very easy to reach out to them.
Could you tell us a bit more about how y'all decided on the different roles that you'd be doing?
Sure, yeah. And this is a very challenging thing because, you know, of course, going into a wind quintet, we just think, well, I'm going to be the clarinet player. And that's it. I just have to get the Nielsen down and the Hindemith and get my repertoire and you know, play. But, you know, serving in this capacity is very different. So speaking for myself, I'm the director of education and outreach. So, you know, on that level, I am in charge, directly in charge of any sort of educational programs that go on in the organization. So right now we have an honors wind quintet that's happening there. The program is meeting for 5 weeks, and it's in Des Moines. It's with five fantastic high school wind players. I'm constantly blown away by how they play. And, you know, even though I'm the director of education, I can't function without the help of my other colleagues and my other friends. So, you know, Des Moines is an area that I'm not as familiar with. So, you know, I'm very familiar with Iowa City, you know, with my in-laws living in the Quad Cities, very familiar with that area. Des Moines, you know, I have connections there, but really don't know the school system nearly as well. So luckily, you know, as our group is kind of looking to expand, you know, luckily our horn player, Katie, she teaches out there at Grandview University. She teaches horn and she directs the wind band out there. So she was able to help me reach out to all these local band directors and to reach out to private lesson teachers. And, you know, it was a collective effort. You know, our oboist said, hey, I know this person teaches out in Des Moines and they have a large studio. So, you know, as an individual member, I oversee those roles, or I oversee, you know, the education portion and all that. But, you know, it really is a collaborative effort from all five members. And not to say that you know, that it's all, even though I'm the director of education, that it's all on someone else or whatever. You know, we're very fortunate that all five of us, again, are so willing to work together, you know, as, you know, as a chamber ensemble should. So, and that's sort of, you know, where, when we were starting to, you know, choose our own individual roles, you know, we took this year to kind of figure out what we thought might work and what wouldn't work. And the nice thing with that is it kind of allowed it to naturally fall into place. You know, and I think that's the most important thing, is that, you know, you do allow your group to have a little bit of that flexibility, not to jump right in and to kind of, you know, sign on the dotted line and then find out 6 months later, you know, oh man, I don't really know if I'm cut out to be executive director or if I want to be the president on the board. You know, and that was the nice thing, like our director of finance, who is Katie, she, you know, it was a very natural role for her, you know, and thank goodness that it's her, because if I was in charge of finances, I'm pretty sure we would be bankrupt on like day two, because I'm just horrible with money and all that. It'd be great. I'd probably put in an order for 12 heckles or something like that. But I can't stress enough how important it is to kind of allow your group to navigate that in a very natural way. And again, I think, you know, one thing that I have been doing a lot of like research on and just sort of letting it kind of get absorbed in myself is the idea of like long distance running. So, and it's really great, you know, and there's one runner, his name's Tommy Rivers Pusey, and he is like just the most fascinating individual, the most fascinating life. But, you know, he says, you know, with long distance running, it's not something that you can do overnight. You know, this is something that very much is something that you commit, and it's hard to see the growth because every day is very small steps. But when you look at it over the span of, say, a year, you see that development. And that's very much, I think, with a nonprofit that's so important, is that, you know, you don't rush into it. You do allow it the time to, okay, you know, I want to do this. I want to kind of see where these steps are going. You know, and you allow it to kind of grow. And again, you know, you may not see the immediate growth in a week or a month, but over the course of the year, yeah, you know, there will be significant growth. And that's so incredibly important to take that time.
Shawn, how are y'all building an audience?
Sure. Yeah, audience building. I mean, that's very challenging. And, you know, we had the added challenge of dealing with COVID, you know, and that, of course, you know, as an organization that's, you know, a wind quintet, but not able to really go out and be a wind quintet, that it's a challenge. It's very hard to do. So, you know, but we took a look at it as a way of capitalizing on, you know, things that are happening. So luckily, you know, at that time, you know, we capitalize on, you know, doing online things and all that. But I think one of the most important things is that we did is we introduced some interdisciplinary outreach programs. So one of my personal favorites is this series that we called the Made in Iowa series. And I really liked it because what the whole premise of it is that, you know, we have some sort of recording, the music that we provide, and, you know, some other, whether if it's dancing or art, you know, sculpture, you know, some other interdisciplinary is inspired off of it. And for our initial inaugural Made in Iowa, our first one that we did, we did a photography contest. And it was, you know, so great to do because, you know, it's something that is so easily accessible for everyone, you know, especially with modern phones and all that, you know, you kind of, you know, the only stipulation that we had is it had to be, you know, a photo of Iowa and like not to have any people in it as opposed to essentially capture the wildlife. And, you know, it was so cool. We thought we may get, you know, 10 or 12 interested applicants. And we got like pretty close to 75 people who were really interested in it. Yeah. And of course, you know, we don't just like write, hey, we're doing this photo contest. It is doing a lot of research for, okay, you know, different areas, you know, outreaching to, you know, different areas in Iowa, letting them know, hey, we're the Wild Prairie Winds, we're, you know, a 501c3 nationally recognized nonprofit. We're hosting this. These are the prizes. You know, if you're interested, let us know. So it really was this, you know, kind of push. But what was nice about that is it did give kind of that audience participation. And that does go with our core mission. To kind of create musical opportunities that transcend beyond the stage, that aren't necessarily, you know, well, we go, we play, and you clap, and, you know, that's it. We really do like having that interaction with our audience, getting to know our community, and really, you know, most importantly, being able to serve those people. With that too, that does take a lot of, you know, research, that does take a lot of understanding, like what is going on. So, in that too, you have to be very careful not to set your audience too wide or too narrow. You know, here, you know, as our organization with only 5 people right now, we're mostly interested in doing things kind of in the state of Iowa. So, you know, of course, we had Iowa City that we did a lot of gigs out there. We've expanded that now to the Des Moines area and sort of kind of filling in some of the in-between, which there's quite a bit. We're taking a look at, of course, going the opposite direction of doing Quad Cities, going up to Sioux City, and of course, filling in all the towns in between. But it takes really getting to know your audience, and also, too, how does that fit in to your mission statement? You know, it's so incredibly important to be able to, you know, yes, you're an organization, but, or a wing quintet, but, you know, how is that all intertwined?
Could you walk us through how and why you launched a podcast?
Oh boy, yes, I can. the podcast that we have, The Humans of Chamber Music, actually is Kim and myself. And Kim and I, you know, we were office mates at University of Iowa when she was teaching assistant, when I was teaching assistant. So, you know, we spent a lot of time together, and you know, we always tossed ideas back and forth. And one idea was this podcast. And again, with COVID, it kind of was this like little project that we kind of took and allowed it to kind of launch. So one of the things with the podcast, you know, we kind of took a look, you know, with chamber music, and we're all very passionate about it. We kind of realized that there weren't that many like interactions with other chamber musicians. And, you know, we were very inspired by, you know, podcasts and things like, you know, the Musik Link. And, you know, that sort of allows you to again, see the musician for who they are as a person. And I think that's so important. And that's something that Kim and I wanted to highlight in our podcast. So, and we thought, well, you know, it'd be great if we did that with chamber music. So we kind of launched that. So right now, the way it's structured, is Kim is the one who usually will do the interviews, and then I'll do kind of more of the behind the scenes editing and all that. We're actually just now getting ready to kind of like do role reversals. So I'll be the one in the hot seat giving the interview questions. So, and Kim will be the one giving the interview. So that's going to be a very interesting, cause you know, you kind of get comfortable with it. But it kind of started out as, you know, kind of a fun thing, you know, and to get to know people who are out there, you know, the first couple guests that were on, we had Spectral Quartet, that were on, and you know, it was really a means to kind of, you know, get them out. Calera Quartet, which is, they won Fish Off last year, they were the gold medal winners. You know, they're all colleagues of ours and friends of ours, you know, at the University of Iowa, so it was very easy for us to, you know, reach out to them. But we've got some other guests that are lined up, and we're kind of hoping this summer to kind of like do a big recording chunk, because, you know, it gets so crazy at the, you know, in the end of these months, you know, leading to summer and leading into winter. So it'd be kind of nice to just have like 5 or 6 interviews and then be able to put them out once a month, you know.
Could you share with us advice on starting your own private teaching business?
Oh boy. Yes, I can. So one of the things I think is crucial to the success of going out any sort of entrepreneurial private lesson teaching, or if you're talking about you know, freelancing, is to really be to really know the area that you're going into. So in specific to private lesson teaching, and speaking from my experience in Texas, I did a lot of research, because of course Texas is such a large area, and coming from Michigan, you know, first off, where do I want to go in Texas? Because if we look specifically there, there's a lot of big hubs, a lot of big areas. Looking at Houston, Austin, you know, DFW, you know, or three that just come to mind that, you know, you can kind of move to the area and really get a lot of students. So it took a lot of research, you know, reaching out to those that I knew that were in the area. And I was very fortunate, you know, when we did decide to do DFW, which, you know, was both with students and also, you know, also with the people that we knew in the area. So me specifically, I was very fortunate that I knew Jennifer Arbach and Scott Poole, who were very established in the area and really helped me out initially whenever I started to start to teach. But, you know, they will introduce me, of course. But then it's up to me to really show, hey, you know, I am worth that recommendation. So it is kind of, you know, going in and giving it 100% commitment, which can be very challenging when you're teaching that quantity of students. You know, it's not uncommon, of course, in Texas to hear, you know, people teach. I would say probably the average is somewhere around 40 or 50 students. But it's very important, you know, to go in and give it that 100% to establish your reputation more on what you do and let that speak rather than say, oh, have you speak for the reputation, verbally speak. You know, you always want someone, especially a band director, because, you know, if one band director says, hey, I need bassoon reads, you want your band director to say, well, you know, Sean's great. You know, here's his email, he'll send you reads, you know, or hey, I've got this problem with students, or hey, I need a master class, who would you recommend to bring in? You know, you want that, because what's going to establish that is how you conduct yourself in a professional sense. You know, because again, those recommendations that those people are giving are an extension of that person, you know. And that's so important, because if you, it's not only, say, if you go in and you're 20 minutes late and, you know, you're not prepared or, you know, whatever the case may be, not only does that look poorly on you, but it also looks poorly on the person who recommends you as well. So it's incredibly important, you know, all these connections that you make, they do, you know, amount and mean to something. So I can't stress enough, you know, and you, it's funny because I just had this conversation with some younger students. You will never know who you will meet down the road or who your interaction with those people down the road. So, I mean, this is a perfect example. I mean, you and I, Julie, are, you know, what, however many years, we'll just say it was yesterday we were playing in Midland, Odessa.
Five, and Richard too, actually, Sean, did you know?
Oh, yeah.
Also a principal bassoonist of the Midland Odessa Symphony and Chorale. Yeah.
So this is like the MOSC principal bassoon meetup.
It is.
Yeah. But, I mean, that goes to show you, you never know what's going to happen. And, you know, there have been so many times in my life that it's not just only bassoonists, but, you know, people that, you know, I played with in undergraduate that, you know, I've reached out to or I've run into again. And, you know, you always want to leave a positive, you know, professional image of yourself. You know, imparting that onto those people, and that's so crucial, especially if you're wanting to establish yourself, if you're just beginning. Because if you do, you know, I hate to say it, but if you do one thing negative, then it's so hard to recover from that. You know, so that means, you know, with private lesson teaching is really having things established. And, you know, don't be afraid to reach out. Because I reached out to, like I said, Scott and Jennifer to see how things were taught down there. Because if I came in and I had, you know, done things out of order or done things that weren't, you know, I don't want to say standard, but were expected, you know, that could look very negative on me as well. You know, oh, do we really want to trust this guy with, you know, really if you're there for a year, you know, that's a lot of bassoons. Like for me, I think I anywhere from 10 to 20 bassoons, depending on the year, you know. And that those, I mean, we all know those first few years are so crucial. So, you know, it is an amount of research. It is those connections and developing yourself as that professional and developing a positive professional image is so crucial.
Shawn, is there something you wish you knew about the music industry back in your 20s?
Oh, boy. You know, it's funny because, you know, even looking back at that, so much has changed, you know, within the last, you know, however long it's been since I've been 20. but, you know, one of the things that I think, you know, as a bassoonist that I really wish I paid more attention to, and even as a musician too, is really being honest with myself in terms of like, I mean, this transcends to just about any level, really. But let's just say specifically with bassoon, just like, you know, how honest I am with, say, fundamentals or reed making. You know, again, kind of going back to running, you know, you have to be honest with yourself about running. Because if you're not, you are going to injure yourself. And that injury could either be very minor or it could be a major injury. And if it's a major injury, I mean, you may not be running for months and it can have a huge detrimental effect. And that's one thing about running in that mentality that I've really appreciated is that the more I run, the more I do that and I'm really analyzing, you know, my form and, you know, my pace and, you know, how much effort I'm putting into my running, the more of that really transcends into my bassoon playing. And the more honest I am, the more I feel like I am getting more positive results quicker. And again, you know, that's something, you know, when I was young, you know, I call it now, oh, it's the good enough mentality, where it's, you know, you play something and, oh, yeah, my skills are good enough. And my tonguing is good enough. And, you know, if you're saying that something is good enough, chances are it really isn't good enough, you know. And, you know, in the long run, that's not a good mentality to have, especially in music. So that's something I wish I knew probably earlier than my 20s as well, let's just be honest.
Mm-hmm. Is there a course from university that you wish that had been offered for you to take?
Ooh, that's a good one. So, yeah, let me say this. Having taken a lot of time off, or I should say a lot of time, but I took 4 or 5 years off between my master's and my doctorate. Within those 4 or 5 years, you know, quite a bit had changed. You know, there was a lot of the orchestral strikes that were happening. You know, when I started in Michigan, there was, of course, Detroit Symphony was on strike. And when I left DFW, Fort Worth was just coming out of their strike. So, you know, the whole landscape had changed. And when I really came back to do my DMA at Iowa, you know, there was also a lot of courses that were being offered in terms of, you know, those who are underrepresented in music. So I don't necessarily know if there are courses that I would say that I wish I would have took, but I think that there are courses that are very instrumental in, I shall say, being a more complete musician, is sort of understanding more of the business side of music. I think that we spend so much of our time in the practice room that we forget that, you know, I always say that we are our own product. And because of that, we have to promote ourselves. We have to be proud of what we produce too. You know, and that's a very difficult thing because in music, we are trained to look for the defects. We are trained to say, this is not right, we need to fix it. So to put that product out there where we mentally know and feel that it's already imperfect is a very challenging thing to do. But we have to remember that, you know, not everyone is going to be looking at it that way. So that's a very important thing. And also, too, like I said, on the other side, especially with all the Black Lives Matter, revelation and all that is, you know, these courses in, you know, when I was at Iowa, I took women in music, I took diversity courses, music and diversity. And I will say, as a DMA student, they were the most eye-opening courses. And I think it's so important that we understand the whole scope of it, you know, and understand that, you know, why is it that you know, music is the way it is? Why we have Mozart, but, you know, maybe other composers aren't necessarily there, you know, at that time. So, I'll say the other thing too, maybe kind of a plug for Iowa that I felt was very crucial. And one of the things that I felt were really helped me solidify my decision for Iowa. There was a music and business course. So I know I kind of alluded to that earlier. But this music and business course kind of prepared the graduate students, especially the DMA students, into getting more knowledge into, you know, writing cover letters, formatting CVs, you know, kind of constructing, you know, what it means to do even your DMA thesis, that is very short term, but kind of, you know, prepping you for that so that you don't go out there and it's like, you know, well, oh my gosh, I've never done a CV before. And the other course too, which I think every institution should have is this, they call it here at Iowa, the Woodwind Pedagogy and Literature course. So it's geared again towards the master's students, master's and doctoral, the graduate students. But what's really nice about it is you learn about the other wind instruments. And it's not so much that, like, it's not a music education course where you're actually playing them, but you're learning, say, as if you're serving on a jury board, what is the appropriate level for, say, clarinet etudes? You know, or, you know, what oboe solo was really considered an intermediate oboe solo and the challenges the oboe may have or the challenges the flute may have. What makes, you know, why, you know, some things about the saxophone easy. And, you know, it was such an eye-opening experience. And, of course, this was all added because, you know, University of Iowa has such a fantastic, you know, faculty here. And especially their wind department is just absolutely phenomenal. But it really gave me an understanding of the wind family as a whole. And I think with that too, I learned much more and I was able to apply a lot of that to the bassoon as well. And, you know, knowing going that I'd like to go into higher education and all that, I felt much more prepared. And even as a chamber music player and an orchestral, you know, understanding, you know, the clarinet, you know, can help me as a bassoonist, you know, to play with them. Same with oboe and flute, you know, because we all know that, you know, they have different tuning tendencies. And same with the bassoon, you know, we get up into that tenor register and, you know, boy, hopefully we're not too flat or anything like that, you know. So they were courses, you know, maybe I'm more fortunate than other people are in their education, or maybe I am overlooking something, but I do think that, you know, trying to fill out more of the bigger picture, yes, having this strong understanding of, you know, the basic music history and the basic music theory, but filling out and, you know, looking at other subjects, especially those that involve self-promotion, and understanding more than just playing the bassoon, I think is absolutely crucial.
Do you have a music book recommendation?
Oh boy. Yes, I do. Yeah. And that was one, when I saw the question, I was like, oh, this is really good. So I actually have three that I'd like to suggest. And I'll start, maybe I'll start with the most specific for bassoon. And it's not a book per se, but it is intended to be a book. So the Council of Canadian Bassoonists are releasing every Friday blog posts written by Christopher Millard. And these blog posts are over Lou Skinner's techniques on reed making. And, you know, then there's, I think, like something like 40 or 50 installments of this, of these remaking techniques. But it is just, the nice thing with Chris Millard is he's so incredibly specific, but it's so digestible as well. And I really appreciate the writing that he does. And of course, Nadina Mackie-Jackson's drawings that she does are fantastic. So I can't stress that enough. It's a free resource. The Council of Canadian Bassoonists website. So that's the first. The second is, again, a bit bassoon specific, but maybe I think other wind instruments can use it. And that is Ole Krishendahl's Drills and Drills 2.0. I found Ola when I think it was Play with a Pro that had come out, and he had just released his videos, and then he released, you know, Drills 1.0. And I meant to check my Drills book before I left, but I think I've got like a super early, like I think it's like number 10 or 15 or something like that. It's pretty early. So I've been a Drills fanatic for a very long time, almost been about 10 years. But what I like about it too, again, is that Ola takes these very complex topics, and he's able to explain them in a very easily digestible format. And so Drills 1.0 is probably the most bassoon specific, in which, you know, he talks about embouchure, vibrato, and tonguing. You know, but I think things like his breathing technique, I think, is very universally applicable to any wind instrument. And then his exercises that are in the back, his fundamental exercises, are absolutely fantastic. Drills 2.0 is a bit more of an in-depth look as to, you know, what it means to be an orchestral bassoonist, some good mentality, some good etiquette to have when you are on a job, when you've won an audition and you're on that trial period. I think there's bassoon fingerings and some more exercises in the back. It's a really, really fantastic resource, and I always suggest it. I suggest it to my students who are very serious about, you know, fundamental practice, you know, advanced high schoolers and whatnot, and college level students. Those exercises are just fantastic. And the third and final one is Kim Walker's book, The Art of Wind Playing. So, of course, you know, Kim Walker's a grand teacher of mine. She's Ben Coelho's teacher when he studied at Indiana University. So I had a little bit more hands-on approach when I first got to Iowa, and then her book came out. And it's a really good, again, it's not bassoon specific, but it definitely applies to wind playing. And it all has to do with, you know, how to develop really good posture, how to develop, you know, to really more, I don't want to say it's just about accident prevention, but it's really about understanding the relationship of your body with the instrument. And, you know, she gives excellent stretches in there and exercises. There's really great mental exercises that she gives in there as well, when she talks about, you know, taking an audition. You know, in terms of, you know, doing energy, because, I mean, Kim Walker, you know, when you really think about, you know, these big name bassoonists, I mean, she's played solos and, you know, played in orchestras all over the world. And, you know, she talks about that. And, you know, also, too, she mentions in her book how she had a very severe car accident and really had to, when she recovered, had to kind of, like, relearn a lot of playing on the bassoon. And you hear her now, and it's, I mean, she's a phenomenal bassoonist, you know. Not that she wasn't before, but, you know, seeing how she went through all of that and to still come out, and she sounds just this beautiful sound and this, you know, wonderful stage presence. You know, I can't recommend the book enough. And that one's probably, you know, you can get that on Amazon, you can get it wherever. And it's a pretty good size book for what you get.
Could you share with us any advice on how to be a good chamber music colleague?
You know, I look at chamber music as, I don't want to say it's not any different from orchestral playing, but there's a lot of parallels with it. And I think one of the things that really helps with chamber music is, you know, understanding your role and how it fits into the group. And again, coming out from a wind player and from someone who is playing in primarily, you know, a wind quintet, you know, when you look at the wind quintet, it's still kind of in its, I don't want to say its infancy, but, you know, definitely maybe the toddler stage. You know, we were very lucky to have Rika and Donzi with their early quintets, but then, you know, there's kind of that period where we didn't really have too much. Then, of course, you know, the mid-20th century, we began to see all these quintets come. So, you know, I think it's very important to understand your role. And especially as a bassoonist, you know, we serve so many roles in the orchestra, and that gets condensed when we get into a role for the wind quintet. Because we are the bass voice, but at the same time, we have to be the tenor voice. And then, you know, our expectations when we start building chords could be very different. In fact, one of the pieces I just got done recording with the quintet, you know, we're trying to figure out these chords, and, you know, we're looking at the score, and it happens that the bassoon is playing the third and the clarinet's playing the root. And just the way the voicing is very different. So, you know, understanding those roles, understanding what to do, and to always go into those rehearsals with an open mind. Because, it's a collaborative venture. And you're working with other individuals, and it's so important that, you know, all those, you know, opinions, all those ideas are represented in some fashion.
I am interested in, out of curiosity, to know over his career, what instruments has he played leading up to acquiring his bell?
Oh boy, that's about another hour discussion, I think. I've had quite a few. Let's see. So I started out my bassoon journey. My very first bassoon was a Musman 200. I think it was an AP or an A. And then I played on that primarily through my undergraduate. And in my graduate studies, I moved on to a Valter bassoon, which are a fantastic instrument. But I found it to be a little inflexible. And it just so happened, you know, I was trialing different instruments, Heckles and Foxes, Buchners and all that. And one of my friends out in the West Coast had this bell, a very early number bell. And he said, well, he says, you know, other people haven't really liked it, but maybe you will. And I tried it, and it was fantastic. It needed work. But it was a fantastic instrument. So that was my first interaction with bell bassoons, and my first interaction with Benson Bell, because I then sent it off to Ben and flew up to Canada and had the instruments essentially overhauled. But with that instrument, I found it to be kind of small in sound. It was a very, very beautiful sound, but it was just a little too small for me. So then I moved to a Musman 222 CL, which again was a fantastic instrument. And then shortly after I got that, Jeff Womack got his bell bassoon. But his bell, which is just like mine, was a thin wall. And it was Ben's new design for his thin walls. And I tried it and fell in love with it. And shortly after, I contacted Ben and said, well, what would be the possibility of me getting something that was made much like Jeff Womack's? And he said, it's not a problem. And, you know, about, I think, 9 months later, I have my bell bassoon, and I've had it for about 4 years, and I haven't really found anything that has made me consider switching. And I've been very fortunate to have tried many other wonderful bassoons. So it's quite the journey, but I think Benson's really doing some excellent work on both thin and thick walls.
Thank you so much for your time today.